Around a year ago, I got this IBM IntelliStation from 2005 or 2006 with a 3 GHz Pentium 4. While it's pretty interesting to have one of the last IBM computers with no mention of Lenovo at all, sadly it's not a remarkable machine. This CPU is 64-bit, so it could theoretically run Windows 11 with bypassed requirements, but the Pentium 4 is incredibly power inefficient, so it's not worth it, even after installing a SATA SSD and upgrading the RAM. Same goes for Windows 10 or a modern Linux distribution. A Core 2 Duo from the same year smokes the Pentium 4 in both performance and energy efficiency, while still being a non-lockdown architecture where you're the one in control instead of the manufacturer. So I tried the opposite. Instead of a new OS, I tried an old OS with some software I barely remember, like Windows 95 or 98. But the Intel 955X motherboard chipset is too new for Windows versions that aren't NT-based. I was able to put together a sort of usable setup after replacing the PCI Express video card with a regular PCI one, but all the missing drivers in Device Manager are kind of bothersome. Also, it freezes every time you shut down if you connect to the network. What ultimately sealed its fate as an unremarkable PC is the horrifyingly crusty capacitors on the motherboard. The computer still works, but I've had a few cases where it would just not do anything upon power-up, so it's definitely on borrowed time. The capacitors could be replaced, but I'm not good with soldering. And besides, is it worth it? Probably not. Oh, let's not forget the incredibly tiny recessed power button, which I had to extend with a little rolled-up piece of paper that looks super tacky. So before it dies completely, I wanted to try something that a handful of people probably swore by when this computer was new. Install a kernel modification from Windows XP to support this particular Pentium 4 with hyper-threading. That's one core, two threads. A few years ago, I made a video where I tried this odd-modified version of Windows XP called WinLSD. I'm sure the kernel mod it includes is available somewhere else, but I'm not embarking on a journey to learn more about it, so I'm just gonna try that OS again. I'm gonna install it on this IntelliStation, bare metal, and see what happens. However, I've ran into a problem. The OS crashed while trying to install devices. All of a sudden, I remember the issue with this computer. The integrated sound chip is by SoundMax, but it has the same hardware ID as a Realtek sound chip, which is not compatible. I was about to give up, but I tried rebooting back to the setup and deleting that port cls.sys file before it crashed. I had a few issues typing because I don't know the French keyboard layout, but eventually I did it, and that allowed setup to continue. At a certain point, it asks if you have a Pentium 4 with HT or a dual-core CPU. And I do, so I'll say yes and continue the installation. However, notice how it says that if you answer the question incorrectly, the system won't boot up. I wanted to compare the kernel it gives you when you answer yes compared to the one when you answer no, so what do I do now? Well, first I finished this installation with the hyper-threading kernel. You can see in the startup options, it doesn't start with the normal ntoskernel.exe. But a file with a different name. It may be an official Microsoft file, but it's not standard, definitely. While I'm here, I can edit the name of the OS entry so I can tell what it is. And now I can install that OS a second time on another drive partition. But on this second installation, I'll say no to the Pentium 4 HT question. This is probably unnecessary, seeing you can just change that line in boot.ini, but I wanted to be sure of the exact changes. The second copy, the one without the hyper-threading kernel, just sits at a blank screen with blinking cursor. But wait, things go more awry. I went to the BIOS to disable hyper-threading, so it acts like a single-core, single-thread CPU, but it still doesn't boot up. And the most unexpected twist? Even without hyper-threading, the first copy, the one with the hyper-threading kernel, still boots up. You can see in Device Manager that the Pentium 4 only appears once now. This is quite puzzling. We can take out the hard drive and compare the two partitions with WinMerge. So one partition is D, and the other is E. Here it's done with the comparison. Of course, the two partitions aren't identical, but let's see. The Windows folder was unable to compare all files in it, but this debug folder isn't necessary to compare. Let's see other differences. As you might expect, the logs are different. Most of them are identical. And let's see if we can spot the two kernel files. Like we have NTOS kernel, but it's not using that. It's using these two. NTKernelMP.exe, that probably stands for multiprocessor. And it's only on the left partition, which was the one with the hyperthreading kernel. So it copies that from somewhere and writes it to boot INI, which, by the way, where is that? Apparently it's only on the left, and it makes sense because the bootloader in the MBR is only in one place, so that goes with the boot.ini as well. So I thought this might be a little more interesting, but it's not. So I don't really know what's going on here, but let's just look at the first copy with the hyperthreading kernel. There's nothing much to say about it. It's a stripped down installation of Windows XP Service Pack 2. With some extra themes and pictures. And Windows Update blocked, which is not optimal. Is it fast? Yeah, but not much faster than a regular installation of Windows XP. So is it worth using this OS on a real Pentium 4 HT? Absolutely not, of course. Even if you have a PC with this CPU, just install a regular copy of Windows XP. This mod did not age well. Anything it offers can be installed separately. Now I think I'll retire this IBM IntelliStation. So that concludes another pointless computer experiment. Thank you for watching.